Amen. Come on, let's give the Lord praise this morning. Amen. Amen. Are you glad to be in the Lord's house today?
Amen.
Amen. Now, here's a brand new song that we want to share with you this morning. And it says that our God has done great things. Has He done great things for you today? Are you thankful for what God has done? All right, here we go. We're just going to sing praise to Him because He's worthy of it. Not just because of what He's done, but because of who He is. He is King of Kings and Lord of Lords and worthy of our praise this morning. Amen? Let's put our hands together like this one. Now sing along.
Come, let us worship our King. Come, let us bow at His feet.
Together. Amen.
Amen. You may be seated this morning. Good morning.
What a beautiful day to gather to worship the Lord this morning. We welcome each one of you to our guests. We're glad that you're here today. We want to meet you. The pastor and I will be out in the foyer at the end of the service. Please come by. Let us say thank you for being here today. Want to welcome those who join us by the way of live stream. First Baptist Church Hendersonville on the beach this morning. Good morning to you. It's fall break, and I know we have a lot. Donna and I were down in Huntsville yesterday at a granddaughter's birthday, and I've never seen 65 South so busy in my life. I text Bruce. I said, have they evacuated Nashville? People are headed to the beach, but we're here to worship the Lord this morning and looking forward to an incredible day together this morning. Let's bow together in prayer, and as we pray this morning, we certainly want to remember those that have been impacted by the storm this past week, both those in South Florida, Georgia, the Carolinas as well. Let's lift them in prayer today. Our Father, this morning, we thank you for the incredible privilege we have to gather as a family of faith, a family that loves one another, a family that enjoys being together, a family on mission, connecting every generation to you, to others, and in service. Lord, we thank you how week by week you are adding to our family. And Lord, we rejoice in the new family members you've given us, the brothers and sisters in Christ. Lord, we thank you for the privilege we have to walk along churches to help revitalize them in Madison and Westmoreland. We thank you for the privilege of being able to start a new church in Hell's Kitchen, New York. And we pray for our high school team that's there today, that's serving this week during their fall break. We pray blessings upon them. We pray that their work will be profitable and there will be fruit. Lord, we do lift up those that have been impacted by the hurricane this past week. Lord, for the families that have lost loved ones, may your comfort, your strength be upon them. For those that are dealing with just the aftermath of the wind and the water, those that have lost their homes, Lord, we pray for them today. We thank you for mission teams that are on their way down there and others that will be going. We pray blessings upon them, but we pray also that you'll allow them to share the gospel of Jesus Christ through all. Lord, today, we want you to do a special thing in our hearts. Lord, do something in mine. Lord, today may Jesus Christ be exalted. Lord, may we worship you with all that we are, with our voice, but also with our lives as a living sacrifice, and may that be a holy, acceptable act of worship. Lord, anoint our pastor today. Speak through him. In Christ Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. For 4 weeks, it is our privilege as a church to celebrate with families that have had additions recently. We do what Scripture says as they bring their children to this special place, and they ask us to pray with them that one day their children will come to faith in Christ, to pray for the parents and grandparents and aunts and uncles, that the Lord would help them to be who they need to be for their children, and for us to be who we need to be as their church body. Last Sunday in the four different worship services, we had five families that came before us. Today we've got five families as well. We'll have more next week, and then the following week, 4 weeks in all. And it's really wonderful to be a part of a growing church. Aren't you glad to have young families that are still in the baby birthing business? And we're delighted to have more and more coming to be a part of our church. Today we have Cody and Katie Lee. Come stand up here with me. Deacon, would you come up here with me, big guy? Deacon is the guest of honor here today. Can I hold you? Would you let me? No, not a chance. Not a chance. You're going to learn that I've got candy in my office, and you're going to like me. One day you're going to like me. This is Savannah. Savannah's six, right? Right? Yeah? Savannah has already been brought before the Lord, and so today we're celebrating Deacon and praying for him. And Deacon turned two. Now you're happy, right? Now can I hold you that you got your truck? No, still can't hold you. Okay. How about I just sit here with you? That work? Huh? Can I sit here like this with you? No, can't even do that. All right. How about I just leave you alone and I just stand over here with Mom and Dad? Well, which camera are we on, guys? Show me which camera's got a good picture. Up there. Deacon, look right up there for just a minute at that red light, because your grandmother Melanie is watching at home. She had surgery recently, and is not that grandmother, that grandmother up there. You can see her. Melanie, he doesn't understand that you're behind that camera. But she had surgery and couldn't be here today. She's in rehab. But Nick and Tina and Jim are all down here front, grandparents. Great-grandmother's over on the side. I saw Nancy a little bit earlier, and they're just family members all over the place. And Deacon, I love your name, man. That's a special name you've got there. And we're praying for you and praying for all of you. And he's not going to let me get anywhere near him. So y'all just come closer. I'm going to get over here so I can kind of get all of you, and let's pray for him. Nick, now I know what you meant when you said good luck. I didn't understand, but now I do. All right, let's pray for this family. Lord, we do thank you for this family, and I pray for Cody and Katie that you would bless them as parents. Thank you for Savannah, big sister. And now I pray for Deacon, Lord, that one day he'll come to faith in Jesus, maybe through Bible school or maybe through Connect Group or maybe just at home with his parents. He'll trust Jesus as his Savior. I pray for him. What a wonderful little boy, and what a great name he has. I pray for this family. And together we dedicate this young man to the Lord Jesus. And we ask you to bless him all the days of his life. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you. Thank you, Deacon. I'm leaving, so you can wave bye to me.
Simple song unto the Lord. Why don't you stand with us and let's sing it together. We love you, Lord. We love you, Jesus. Let this be a time between you and the Lord. Just sing to him this morning. We love you, Lord. We love you, Jesus. For your arms keeps us. We love. Amen. Come on, let's give the Lord a big ovation of praise this morning. You may be seated.
you so much. Thank you, Lydia. Lydia Kumar, she and her family are from India. We've got several families from India in our church, and she, it's fun to watch someone. She used to sing in the children's choir things and then with students and now singing with adults. It's wonderful to see these kids grow up and use their talents for the Lord. Thank you, choir. Thank you, orchestra. Wonderful worship today. Take your Bible and find Luke chapter 5. We've come to the fifth chapter now as we're making our way through this study in the Gospel of Luke. And we've come to a familiar passage today, and one that you know at least parts of it. You know very well the story itself of what's happening here. We're very familiar with it. Now, last week in the passage at the end of the fourth chapter, Jesus showed his authority both over demons and over sickness as he cast out a demon and as he healed someone with a disease. We're going to see his authority in a little bit different way in the passage today as he begins the process of calling his disciples to follow him. Now, this passage that I'm going to read this morning, we're going to look at this passage for 2 weeks. I'm going to read the same passage today that I'm going to read next week because I want to look at this from two different angles. I want us to consider it two different ways. Next week, we're going to look at specifically that part of the passage at the end where Jesus said, and this is the way I learned it as a boy, "Follow me and I'll make you fishers of men." This translation says, "Follow me and I'll make you a fisher of people." And we'll look at that concept of being a fisher of men next week. But today I want to look at it from the standpoint of Jesus calling us, Jesus giving instructions to us, and his desire for us to listen to him and to obey him and to follow him. So what I'm going to do today is read the passage, and then I'm going to show you some principles that you can take from this passage that I think truly apply to all of our lives, and then I'll try to give you a few so whats as we get to the end of it. What does this have to do with me today in 2022? So let's look at the passage beginning in chapter 5. It's in verse 1. As the crowd was pressing in on Jesus to hear God's word, he was standing by Lake Gennesaret. He saw two boats at the edge of the lake. The fishermen had left them and were washing their nets. He got into one of the boats, which belonged to Simon, and asked him to put out a little from the land. Then he sat down and was teaching the crowds from the boat. When he had finished speaking, he said to Simon, "Put out into the deep water and let down your nets for a catch." "Master," Simon replied, "we've worked hard all night long and caught nothing. But at your word, I'll let down the nets." When they did this, they caught a great number of fish, and their nets began to tear. So they signaled to their partners in the other boat to come and help them. So they came and filled both boats so full that they began to sink. When Simon Peter saw this, he fell at Jesus' knees and said, "Go away from me, because I'm a sinful man, Lord." For he and all those with him were amazed at the catch of fish they took, and so were James and John, Zebedee's sons, who were Simon's partners. "Don't be afraid," Jesus told Simon. "From now on, you'll be catching people." Then they brought the boats to land, left everything, and followed him. Now I want to show you four principles out of this passage that I think will help you. It helps me as I consider how this passage really applies to my life. Here's the first thing. Jesus gives us directions, and then he watches to see how we respond. Jesus gives us directions, and then he watches to see how we respond. Now look at the passage. Verse 1, let me just give you a little background here. Verse 1 says, he was standing by Lake Gennesaret. Now that's a new name for us. Where is this Lake Gennesaret, and what's it talking about? Well, Lake Gennesaret is the same as the Lake of Galilee or the Sea of Galilee. Some people are surprised when they go there to learn that it is not a sea at all. It is an inland lake. It's a freshwater lake. It is fed from the water that comes out of Mount Hermon, a 12,000-foot mountain very nearby. The Jordan River flows out of the base of that mountain and down into the Sea of Galilee, out of the Sea of Galilee, down the Jordan River Valley, into the Dead Sea where it ends. This lake is about 13 miles long, At its widest point, it's about 7.5 miles wide, but it is a freshwater inland lake, and it is called by several names throughout Scripture. In the Old Testament, it is usually called the lake or the Sea of Kinnereth. Kinnereth. Sometimes you see that spelled with a C-H, pronounced with a K. Sometimes you see it spelled with a K. Kinnereth is a word that scholars believe that word means a harp, a musical instrument, a harp. And if you look at the Sea of Galilee from a satellite, I don't know how they knew this. I don't know how they figured this out. But if you look at it from the air, it is roughly in the shape of a harp. And in the Old Testament, it was called the lake or the Sea of Kinnereth. In the New Testament, sometimes it was called the Sea of Tiberias or Lake of Tiberias. Tiberias is a town on the western shore of the Sea of Galilee. It was named for the emperor, Tiberias. Tiberias had done something to favor the people of Israel, and particularly Galilee. And for a season of time, they called this lake the Lake Tiberias or the Sea of Tiberias. That name didn't last very long. The other name that it is occasionally referred to is this one, Lake Gennesaret. But it's talking about the same thing, the one that 99 times out of 100, we call it the Sea or the Lake of Galilee. So that's where they are. They've left Capernaum right on the shore of the Sea of Galilee, and now this incident occurs. And look at what it says in verse 3. He got into one of the boats which belonged to Simon, and he asked him to put out a little from the land. Look in verse 4. When he had finished speaking, he said to Simon, put out into deep water and let down your nets for a catch. Now, get this picture in your mind. Simon and James and John, other fishermen, had been out fishing all night. They still do that, by the way. If you go to the Sea of Galilee today, you'll see commercial fishermen coming in from fishing all night long. Maybe a little bit in a different way, but pretty much doing the same thing. They had fished all night long. Their method of fishing was not with a rod and reel or a Zebco or a cane pole. Their method of fishing was with nets, and they would take these nets and cast them and let them sink with weights on them. They would sink to the bottom. They would pull those nets in, hoping to get a catch with every pull. And this particular night, Scripture says they had fished all night long and caught nothing. Now, when a fisherman tells you he caught nothing, you can bank on that. Now, when he tells you how many he caught or how big they were, you might want to take that with a grain of salt. But when he says, I caught nothing, you can pretty much take that to the bank. He caught nothing, and they haven't had any luck that night. They have finished fishing, and they've done what they always do. They have taken their nets. They always have things to clean out of them. They've picked up debris. They've got twigs. Sometimes they get torn. They've been pulled across debris on the bottom of the lake, snagged on rocks. They've gotten torn. They clean their nets. They wash their nets. They mend their nets. They put them together to be ready for the night so that when they go home, get some sleep, get something to eat, they can come back that night ready to fish again. That particular day, these fishermen were finishing up their project of cleaning their nets, and Jesus came and got in Simon's boat. And he said, I want you to push me out a little bit from shore. Now, Jesus did that several times. You remember that he would, when the crowd was pressing in on him, he would get in a boat and push out from the land so that he could talk to the people on the land while he was in the boat. Simon Peter dutifully did what he asked him to do. And then Jesus said, now I want you to go out into the deep water, and I want you to cast your nets again. Now, Jesus is watching to see if Peter is going to do what he's asked him to do. Now, if he didn't do the first thing, if he didn't push out a little bit from the shore to let Jesus get in the boat to speak to the crowd, he would never have experienced the second thing that Jesus taught him to do, because his revelation of his plan for all of this was revealed gradually. You know, that's the way God often works with us. I believe that if God had come to me when I was a young man and shown me in living color what my life would hold and the challenges and the opportunities the responsibilities. If God had shown me where my life was going to take me, I think in my earliest years it would have scared me to death. I don't think that there are times in our lives when we would be able to handle knowing all of the mountain peaks, all of the valleys, all of the heartache, all of the struggles, all of the things that you've gone through in your life. If God had just, if he had just laid that on you when you were young and said, I want to show you what your life is going to be, it would have probably immobilized you and scared you to death. But God reveals his will to us in a gradual, continually revealing way. And as we walk through one door of life, God opens another door. Now, if we don't walk through that door, oftentimes we don't know what God had for us if we had simply obeyed then. You know, it'd be a little bit like if you decided tonight after dark that you're going to drive down to Nashville or go up to Bowling Green. When you turn the headlights on your car, those headlights do not illumine your destination. You can't see Nashville. You can't see Bowling Green. But when you pull that car out of the driveway, and as those lights are giving you light in front of you, those lights are constantly going to stay in front of you, and as you go down that road, it is going to light more and more and more, and as you go, there will be a gradual lighting of your journey until you get to your destination and you see where you set out to go from the very beginning. That's often the way God's will is. If you will follow his will, if you will obey him, if you'll do what he tells you to do, he will reveal more of his plan. If you'll go through a door when he opens it, you will see the next door that he has for you, the next avenue that he has for you, the next path that he has for you. Jesus often gives us direction, and then he waits to see how we respond. Here's the second principle. Jesus wants to know that we trust him to know more about things than we do. He wants to know that we trust him to know more about things than we do. Now, you know, this would have been very tempting for Peter to say. When Jesus said, he got him into the boat, he pushed him out, he let him teach the crowd, and then Jesus said, well, while we're here, let's just push out a little deeper. I want you to cast your nets again. Peter could have very easily said, now, Lord, you know a lot about carpentry, and you know a lot about teaching, and you know more parables than I've ever even imagined, but I know more about fishing than you know. And we've been there and done that. We have fished all night. We have cast our net on this side and that side. We know the best fishing spots. This is what we do for a living. It would have been very tempting for Peter to say, I know a little bit more about this than you do. Now, we don't have any trouble trusting Jesus about things we know nothing about. We don't know what heaven is like, and so we just take God's word and we read it and we try to imagine what this says it's going to be like because we don't know. We don't know what it's like to walk through death because we haven't done that. We don't know how the world's going to end. We just trust that when we read about these things that we know nothing about, we just trust God because he does know and we don't. But when it comes to something we know about, you're talking about my life and my family, and my business, and my decisions, and my money. You're talking about something that I know a whole lot about. One of the things Jesus wants us to get to a point to is that we trust him. We trust him to know more than we know. Now, Peter had to, he had to kind of quieten several voices in his head at that moment. He had to quieten that voice of personal experience, the been there, done that voice. We've already cast the nets. He had to quiet the voice of human reason that said, look, I've been fishing all night. I'm ready to go home. I need to go see my wife. My mother-in-law's been sick, remember? I'm hungry. He had to quiet the voice of human fatigue. And sometimes, I'm telling you, sometimes we miss God's plan for our lives because we're just worn out. I want to go home and get in bed and get some rest. I've got to do this again tonight. I got to be back here in just a few hours. Let me go home. He had to quiet all of those voices and decide that he was going to trust Jesus to know more about everything than he did. And so he pushed out into the deep, and he cast his net. Here's the third principle. God's word is our authority in everything. Did you see what he said there in verse 5? Master, we've worked hard all night long. We've caught nothing. Look at the next phrase. But at your word, I'll let down the nets. Now, Jesus was dealing with the spoken word. We've got the written word. Now, I know that there are times in your life and you're seeking God's plan and you're seeking God's will, and it's personal to you, and you're trying to determine how God wants you to go in a decision that you've got to make, and you're really seeking that out, and you're looking for principles, and you're looking for God's leadership. You need to sense that in your own spirit. But I'm telling you that many times, maybe even most of the time, you want to know what God's will is, just open the book and read it, because it's right here. It's God's word, and it's God's will, and it is our authority for life. You know, a lot of people don't read the Bible. They just don't read it. And we're living more in a culture of people that don't know anything about the Bible. Years ago, I used to be able to stand up in front of a congregation and say, well, you know, over where it says, and I'd mention something, and everybody knew exactly what I was talking about, and most people knew where it was. These days, you can't take that for granted. We've got people that are biblically illiterate. They're searching for the Lord, and God's doing something, and they're here, but they don't know anything about the Bible. Some people, though, read the Bible for inspiration and maybe for just the beauty of it. You know, they just read it. It's just like a book. They like the poetry or the history. They just read it, but they don't really do anything with it. God wants us to read his word with the intent of obeying it. The real question is, are we doing what it says to do? Are we living like it says to live? Peter said, at your word, because you said this. You know, sometimes that's just what it comes down to. I don't want to do it. I don't feel like doing it, but at your word. Because your word is truth, I'll do it. Here's the fourth principle. Obedience produces results. Now, did you see what happened? Picture this in your mind. Peter, he's a little bit, he wouldn't say this, but he's a little bit ticked off. He's a little bit agitated because he's just finished cleaning the nets. He's got everything put away. He's ready to go home. He's tired. He's hungry. Jesus asked him to push out from the land so he could teach. He did that. And then he said, let's go out further. I want you to cast your nets again. And Peter is thinking, I just cleaned them. I just finished putting them up. I don't want to do this again. But he said, I'll do what you said. And he cast the net, and he's pulling it in. Can you see, Peter? He's pulling those nets in. They were heavy. He starts pulling them, and he thinks, well, now, great. It's hung on something. It's hung on a tree down on the bottom of the lake. It's hung on a big rock, and he's pulling it, thinking, I'm going to tear my net now. Thanks, Jesus. And as pulling a little bit harder, he begins to feel. Every fisherman understands the feel that I'm talking about. That it's not a log on the bottom of the lake. It's not a rock that it's caught on. This is pulling back. There's something in these nets. And he begins to pull a little bit harder and a little bit harder. He calls for James and John. Help! You're not going to believe this. Get over here. And they come over in their boat, and the catch that he makes The scripture says it's so great that he fills up his boat to the point that it begins to sink, and he fills up their boat to the point that it's about to sink. And when they get all the fish in the boat, they probably all looked at each other as if to say, "Can you believe that?" And Peter turned and fell at Jesus' feet and said, "I'm a sinful man." You know what he was saying? I was wrong. I didn't want to cast that net. You ever had to say that to the Lord? I didn't want to cast that net where you told me to cast it. I didn't want to do what you told me to do. Peter said, "I'm a sinful man." Now, what are the so what's that come out of this passage? Let me give you a couple of them. First of all, obey God's word. We need to read God's word. We need to study God's word. But most of all, we need to live God's word. Take God's word, apply it to your life, and do what it says to do, because obedience produces results. Second, so what that I would really say to you, this passage, and you're not going to think of what I'm thinking of when I say this, but here's the so what. Go out into deep water. Go out into deep water. Now, most people, when you talk about going deep, they think you're talking about another Bible study. And we're going to spend an hour talking about one verse, and that means we're going to go real deep, deep. To me, that's not what it means to go deep. You want to go deep with the Lord? Obey him. You want to go deep with the Lord? Do what he says do. You want to go deep with the Lord? Serve the Lord with gladness. Enter his courts with praise. When we obey the Lord and do what he has told us to do, there are results in our lives. Imagine what it would have been like if Peter had not obeyed him that day. If Peter had not followed him, cast out into the deep. I mean, in just a few years, Peter is going to preach a sermon on the day of Pentecost, and 3,000 people are going to be saved in one day. So what's the Lord saying to you? I'll guarantee you there's somebody in this room that he is calling you to trust him for salvation. You've never trusted Jesus as Savior. And he's calling you. He wants you to be saved. You don't have to fix your life to be saved. You don't clean yourself up and come to him. You come to him just as you are. And he takes you and mold you into who he wants you to be. I'll guarantee you there's someone here today and that God's been saying to you, you need to follow me in believer's baptism. You're saved, but you've never publicly professed that salvation before other people. You need to follow the Lord in baptism. For someone, it's becoming a part of this church. For someone else, it's something else God's been saying to you, something you need to do. You want to go deep? Obey him. Do what he's told you to do. Walk through the door that he's opened, and you'll be amazed that on the other side will be another door. And when you walk through the first one, he'll open the next one. Obey him, and he will reward you. Let's pray. Father, thank you. This is a great passage, an old story that we've all heard all our lives. Remind us that you know more than we know, and we can trust you in every area of life. And remind us that you often give us direction and then wait to see how we respond. Help us, Lord, to obey you. Help us to follow you. Help us to trust you. And the end result will be that obedience produces results. I pray for someone right here, right now, today, in this moment. You've been speaking to them, and it's time for them to respond. They will either decide right now that they will walk through that door, and they will see what blessings are on the other side, or they will close it. They will ignore the leading that you've given to them. Help us, Lord, to obey you right now. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's stand together. Pastor Bruce and I are waiting. Jason's going to lead us as we sing. If the Lord leads you, don't wait. Obey Him today.
Just as I am with
Pastor and Jason, what a blessing it's been to be in the Lord's house today with our church family. If you have a spiritual decision to make, Pastor and I will be out in the foyer almost every week. It's our privilege to be able to visit with people and counsel and pray with people there. Please come by. We would be honored to do so. If you're a guest, we want to meet you as well. Come by. We have a gift for you. Church members, don't forget 2 weeks from today is our church picnic. It's the time that we all get to be together at the same place at the same time. We're going to be out at Saunders Ferry Park this year on Sunday afternoon the 16th. If you'll register out at the table in the foyer, grab a wristband for each family member that's going to attend. We can be prepared to make sure we have plenty of food. We're going to have a great time that day. Also, an incredible ministry we have is Celebrate Recovery. It meets every Tuesday evening in Wilson Hall. Out in the foyer is a table. Some of the leaders will be there. If you'd like to learn more information about that ministry, go by there this morning. Jason.
Sing this chorus.
Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee.
Sing to the Lord.
How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee.
You guys have a great rest of your day.